I am not rejection. I am not a blizzard. I am not nails on a chalkboard. I am not overdose. I am not a failure. I am not discrimination. I am not abuse. I am not homophobia. I am not racism. I am not stigma. I am not injustice. I am not perfect. So much I am not. So much I will never be. So much I am. So much I see within me. I am sushi. I am cats. I am hot pink. I am an artist. I am my best friends. I am a misfit. I am my cohorts. I am strong. I am mindfulness. I am confidence. I am a woman. I am a daughter. I am a sister. I am family. I am a survivor. I am a social activist. I am an art therapist. My journey began when I realized that I wanted to become an art therapist. I wanted to help individuals of all backgrounds. I thought I could help them move on from past cultural experiences and any emotions they might be hanging on to because of it. Little did I know, those cultural experiences never died. They are alive and well, especially now, during this political era where racism, homophobia, sexism, and the mental health crisis appear to be at their highest peak. As I came into college and entered the field of art therapy, I realized that I was so distracted with trying to maintain equality for all in my heart that I was blind to the struggles individuals face, many of which I will never understand. We cannot understand experiences and feelings of oppression unless we live in the culture of which those struggles are directed towards. What we can do is learn how to acknowledge personal bias, our role in the cycle, and apply solutions for social injustices, even those we can't personally identify with. I would like to tell you a little bit about some of my art pieces that helped me with my personal journey. Painting mixed media project I created during my studio art class. This was in response to a shooting in 2016 in Orlando, Florida at a LGBTQ club called Pulse. During this event, an individual fired a gun, injured, and killed many individuals. I am passionate about the rights, beliefs, and values of this community, and hearing this news really devastated me. I identify as a bisexual and personally related to this event, despite not knowing any of the victims or their families. I thought about how afraid I would have been if I had been in that situation. I imagined the fear of the victims in the club, staring into the barrel of a gun, wondering if now would be the time that they lose their life. I decided to depict that feeling for others of staring into that barrel. It gives a sense of severity and trauma that this event caused the community. I found a magazine that included an article about the victims, which had small pictures of their faces attached and some descriptions about their lives. I didn't know any of the victims personally, but I wanted the world to see their faces and to get to know those faces. They're the same faces of a culture that has been a target for terror and harassment for years. This image rises up intense feelings in me whenever I look at it and when I show others. Some people have stated the gun makes them feel uncomfortable, to which I can only respond with how uncomfortable it must have felt to actually see that gun in person. I knew from then on, I wanted to continue making art that was true to my desire to advocate for oppressed populations. The next piece I would like to talk about is my practicum and first part of my internship art piece. I created this image from a three-dimensional standpoint to depict myself as an art therapist collaborating with a team of two social workers. I had spent a lot of time on this piece, but often found myself frustrated and complexed with it. It came to the point that when I was finished, I was just finished with it. I haven't tried to touch it really since the ending of my last semester internship. But when I was processing my art piece, it was brought to my attention that the head on my art piece that was supposed to be me, there were no eyes. This really shocked me, because in a lot of the art pieces that I've made, I make a lot of images that depict eyes. Eyes that are open. Never really eyes that are closed, much less no eyes at all. I noticed the eyes appear again in another piece I created shortly after this, depicting a fist holding the space of many skin colors and cultural identities. Within this fist, there were pieces of the human body, including open eyes. It was then I realized I had this idea of myself as a truly culturally competent individual, but I still had my own bias and frustrations with understanding the many perspectives of others. It was then that I realized that I wanted to become an art therapist and practicing social activist. I tried to use my art to advocate for others and continue to improve my competence to better assist clients of all backgrounds at my internship. On another personal level, I decided to create a few art pieces that advocated for women who have been victims of any forms of abuse. I am a survivor myself, with experience of verbal abuse from people who took advantage of me during really low points of my life. It was a challenge to work through my master's program and internship while figuring out my own identity again. Being told I am too much of this, too little of that, I was called crazy for standing up for myself and even having a smidge of suspicion if I was being verbally abused. While creating my art, I felt a huge sense of empowerment, as if I was advocating for not only others, but myself as well. I created images that involved mixed media and gathered found objects to create a suit of armor for a woman in the image, who I refer to as myself. I think about the armor as a means of advocacy and pride, protecting myself and those around me. I noticed in my art that my mouth was being covered by parts of pink hair. I believe this is my way of acknowledging the challenging road still left ahead of me. I also believe that this reflects on a hard lesson that I learned, that sometimes you just need to listen and be present, and simply caring about others is enough. I believe this was a massive part of the impact I had on my internship site, the kiddos I saw, and being able to rearrange this method of holding the space for clients of diverse populations. The next piece I created was also related to my past experience with abuse. An archetype I started to think of myself as was the scapegoat. From what I know about the term scapegoat and the archetype it could represent, it's when you feel like you are the center of blame for others' problems. I felt this on a deep level based on my past experiences and being blamed for so many things that were out of my control, so many things that involved other people, but somehow I was still to blame. All I could think about is the fact that nobody can control me anymore. Nobody has that kind of leverage over my head. and it was a really empowering feeling. My image depicts a skull with goat horns. The skull has a water hose in its mouth and its extinguishing flame surrounding the skull head. The phrase, "You can't control me," hangs within the fire. This piece helped me understand my confidence that I was starting to build in my personal life and my clients' lives. I began to follow my own instincts and stopped focusing on what others expected me to do. I thought of myself as the skull with goat horns, known to me as the scapegoat. I am putting out the flames of my past and bringing a positive and empowering change to my art, my life, and those of my clients that I have seen and have yet to see. I started to think about my art for advocacy, about struggles I could never personally understand. During this time, the trial for a white male officer who shot and killed a young black male in Pittsburgh named Antoine Rose occurred. The officer was found not guilty on all charges. Over the years, I have been hearing more and more about this theme of black males being shot by white officers who say they shot to kill in an attempt to protect themselves from potential harm. Although in this scenario, Rose was suspected to have a gun in his possession before being stopped by the officer, at the time of the shooting, there was no gun at the scene. There was no threat. And now, a life is lost. I remember a large number of particularly white individuals trying to reason as to why the officer was just doing this job and this uproar is making him the victim. But there's still the fact that a life was lost when there was no threat. And this is a trend that seems to be happening, and it's not right. But I realized that even though I think it's not right, I could never truly understand that fear that black men have when they get pulled over by an officer because of these experiences that have occurred. I'll never be able to personally identify with this social injustice because I am not black. I decided I want to create a large painting in response to my thoughts on how to redefine anger and how to cope with social injustices. I spent a few hours on my artwork using colors that I felt represented anger, such as red, orange, and yellow. I layered colors that I believe could symbolize a collective, such as blue, pink, and green. I moved around the entire canvas, making art on a large canvas, which I have never done before. This piece is almost as big as I am. That's pretty crazy for me to grasp that I had done. But it feels really powerful. It felt really powerful to take on such a large space and covering it with an idea all of my own. It made me think about the journey of being a social activist and continuing to embark on the journey to spread awareness of art therapy to public schools and continue fighting the many situations of oppression that exist. I thank you all for following this journey with me. This isn't just the end of a journey as an art therapy intern. This is the end of an era at Seton Hill University. I first came here in 2010. Just a girl fresh out of high school with a camera in her hand, telling everyone she likes to take pictures and she wants to help people. Now, it's 2019. I'm leaving with a master's degree in art therapy. And I feel like, as one of my professors described me as, a rainbow neon pink crayon rocket ship through the sky. I want to change lives. I don't just want to help people. I don't just want to be there. I want people to know that there is hope in this world to make things different and to make schools, in particular, a better place for students to flourish in and leave school in to continue their own journeys and make this world a better place.
Dear Mr. Vernon, We accept the fact that we had to sacrifice a whole Saturday in detention for whatever it was we did wrong. But we think you're crazy to make us write an essay telling you who we think we are. And you see us as you want to see us. In the simplest terms, with the most convenient definitions. But what we found out is that each one of us is a brain.
And an athlete.
And a basket case. A princess.
And a criminal.
Does that answer your question? Sincerely yours, The Breakfast Club. Don't.